Hello everyone, today in this video I am going to talk about neonatal genetics. This is part 1 of my video series on neonatal genetics. In this I will tell you the details of physiological neonatal genetics. In newborn, in most of the cases genetics is benign physiological, which does not require any treatment. Only in 10% cases clinically significant genetics occur and which will require the treatment. And genetics appear when the total serum bilirubin is more than 7 mg per dl. Whenever you find a newborn with the genetics, first thing should be clear that is it physiological or pathological. If it is pathological, then there are long list of the investigation which we have to perform and accordingly we have to treat. While for the physiological, just we have to observe the newborn. And it is very common, it's seen in the 60% of the term and 80% of the preterm newborns because of the increased bilirubin production from the breakdown of the fetal RBC, and also newborn is having the transient limitation in the conjugation of the bilirubin because of the immature liver. So first thing should be, is it physiological or pathological? I will tell you the details why physiological neonatal genetics is such a common thing. Now, bilirubin turnover in newborn. As we know, the lifespan of the RBC in adult is around 120 days, while in the newborn it is 90 days. So, because of the shorter lifespan, RBC will be hemolyzed more, and around 1 ml per kg of the RBCs or blood hemolyzed daily in newborn. So around 0.15 gram per kilogram of hemoglobin released daily from this 1% hemolyzed blood, and it will convert into the bilirubin by hemoxygenase and biliverdin reductase enzyme, and around 5 mg per kilogram per day bilirubin produced daily. So if the weight of the newborn is 3 kg, then by heme source around 15 mg bilirubin will be released daily. And by non-heme source, example myoglobin or catalase, 1 mg per kilogram bilirubin will be released daily, and it will be around 20 mg of bilirubin load daily in the full term newborn. So higher bilirubin load will lead to the physiological jaundice, and around 1 gram hemoglobin convert into the 34 mg bilirubin, and after binding to the ligandin Y and Z acceptor, it will goes to the liver, and this unconjugated bilirubin, which is the lipid soluble, will be converted into the conjugated water soluble bilirubin in liver by the enzyme UDP glucuronyl transferase, and this is also not fully active in the newborn, and this will convert the unconjugated bilirubin into the conjugated bilirubin, bilirubin diglucuronide, and this will be excreted in the bile, and this bile goes to the intestine, and this will convert into the stercobilin by bacteria, and this stercobilin will be excreted in the stool, and around 1 mg bilirubin per gram of meconium is excreted, and there is enterohepatic circulation in which the beta glucuronidase enzyme will convert the bilirubin diglucuronide into the unconjugated bilirubin. So why the physiological jaundice appear in the newborn? So first thing is that RBC is having the short lifespan. Because of that, more bilirubin is produced in the newborn. Second thing is higher bilirubin production will be there. And third thing is ligandin YZ acceptor is also limited in amount in newborn. And also the UDP glucuronyl transferase activity is not fully active in the newborn. And fifth thing, because of the increased enterohepatic circulation, more and more conjugated bilirubin convert into the unconjugated by the beta glucuronidase. Because of all these reasons, physiological jaundice is present in the newborn. So, around 1% blood hemolyzed daily, increased bilirubin synthesis, and less efficient binding and transport of the bilirubin, and less efficient hepatic conjugation, and increased enterohepatic circulation. All these five causes are responsible for the physiological jaundice in newborn. How will you define the physiological jaundice? If jaundice is appears between 24 to 72 hours of life and disappear before 14 days of life in term baby and before third week of life in preterm baby, and in cord blood, indirect bilirubin is around 1 to 3 milligram per dl, and peak level of the bilirubin is between 12 to 15 milligram per dl, not more than 15, and especially around 12 in term baby and around 14 to 15 in preterm baby, and peak occur between 3rd to 5th day of life in term baby and between 6th to 7th day of life in preterm baby, and bilirubin is rising at less than 5 mg per dl per day, then we label as a physiological jaundice. If the jaundice is present in less than 24 hours or after 14 days, and in umbilical cord blood if it is more than 5 and peak level is more than 15 mg per dl and it is rising more than 5 mg per dl per day, then we label as a pathological jaundice. Now this graph is showing that in term baby, peak is present around the 4-5th day and disappear around 11th to 12th day of life. While in the preterm baby, you can see the peak is around 6th to 7th day of life and it disappears after 14 days of life. So by this graph, you can easily understand when the physiological jaundice appear, when the peak occurs and when it disappears. And you can see the peak level of the bilirubin is less than 15 milligram per dl. Then and then you can say it is physiological, otherwise it will be pathological. Now sometime patient is having the exaggerated physiological jaundice because of the various risk factors. So if you see the risk factor, if the age of the mother is more than 25 years and it is more in the male's age, if mother is having diabetes, or if the oxytocin induction was done during the delivery, if the child is premature, then it is a risk factor for the exaggerated physiological jaundice. If there is a history of drugs, large dose of vitamin can lead to the exaggerated physiological jaundice, and physiological polycythemia is common in the preterm baby and it will lead to the exaggerated physiological jaundice. If the child is having Down syndrome trisomy 21, then, and if the child is having bleeding from either in cephalhematoma or having ecchymosis or any form, then obviously child will develop the exaggerated physiological jaundice. If due to the inadequate feeding, child will develop the breastfeeding jaundice, in which the weight loss, dehydration and calorie deprivation will lead to the exaggerated physiological jaundice. And if delayed bowel movement due to any reason, due to intestinal obstruction or anything, then there will be exaggerated physiological jaundice. If the previous history, family history of the sibling who had the physiological jaundice, then there will be more chances of developing the exaggerated physiological jaundice. For the assessment of the severity of the jaundice, we have to examine the baby, and by Kramer's rule, by physical examination, we can assess the level of the jaundice. So in this video, you can see by pressing the skin, and we have to check the color of the blanched skin, and always we have to examine the baby in bright natural light. And if the child is having the unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia, then the color will be light yellow. While in conjugated hyperbilirubinemia, the color will be dark yellow or orange. And jaundice progress in the cephalocaudal fashion. And if the child is having the jaundice over the face, then the bilirubin level will be around 4 to 6 milligram per dl. If the child is having the jaundice up to the chest, then the bilirubin level will be around 6 to 8 milligram per dl. If the child is having jaundice up to the abdomen and thigh, then the level will be between 8 to 12 milligram per dl. And if the child is having over the limbs, then this is the zone 4. In this, bilirubin level will be between 12 to 14 milligram per dl. If palm sole is also pale, then it is correlated with the bilirubin level of around more than 15 milligram per dl. So according to this physical examination, at least we can screen out the babies and we can go further. If we find that palm sole is also stained, then we can rule out the various causes of pathological jaundice by doing the screening test for the pathological jaundice. In this video, you can see the transcutaneous bilirubinometer. It is used for the screening. It is unreliable in infant less than 35 week gestation and during the initial 24 hours of life. It is also unreliable when the bilirubin level is more than 14 milligram per dl is recorded. So whenever you find that level is more than 14, always and always correlate with the serum bilirubin level. Total serum bilirubin will be indicated whenever you find that elevated age specific TCB measurement. If the child is having progressive jaundice and you find in physical examination that the palm sole is also pale, and if there is any risk factor for hemolysis or for infection, or if any risk factor for the exaggerated physiological jaundice, example if the child is having the cephalhematoma and if prematurely delivered newborn, then we have to go for the total serum bilirubin level. And if the child is on phototherapy, then definitely we have to repeat the total serum bilirubin level at every 12 to 24 hours interval till the child is in the range of the phototherapy. Thank you so much.